Hello again. So we are back in the Baltimore area for a little while. We had a good 3 weeks on the road. We had a good 3 weeks up on the road. Went up to the Laurel Highlands in Pennsylvania. Definitely give that a thumbs up. We spent a week there. Could definitely spend two, three, maybe even a month. Went down to Shenandoah National Park. And again, I do have to say with Shenandoah National Park, I had been to Shenandoah National Park before. And again, as like an East Coast person, always living on the East Coast, you look at it and you're like, oh, look, mountains with trees. Woo! Right? But I do have to say now that I have a little age on me, going back there, really like Shenandoah National Park. The only issue I found with Shenandoah National Park is it's that whole Grand Canyon thing. Down is optional, up is not. The issue you run into with Shenandoah National Park is normally with mountains. You go out up. The first half is up and the second half is down. Thing with Shenandoah National Park is you have the Skyline Drive, which is this drive that goes along the ridgeline, which is really nice, 100 miles along the ridgeline, and all the trails are off of that. So you start at the top of the mountain and then go down, which isn't horrible. It isn't horrible. It's just you do have to be a little careful because, again, you're going to go a 10, 12, however long mile hike. It's really nice to think, you know, the first 6 miles are going to be hardest and the second 6 miles are going to be pretty easy. It screws with you a little bit when the final 6 miles are the ones that are a bugger. You're like, oh, I've already been hiking 6 miles. I don't want to hike another 6 miles uphill. But that was good overall. And then, like I said, the Smoky Mountains were just, they were just absolutely and utterly magnificent. Can definitely spend a month there. And hopefully we will at some point. So we are here for right around 2 weeks. And then we'll be taking off again for the Adirondacks. So the Adirondacks, upstate New York. If you haven't heard about the Adirondacks, again, another amazing place. Now the thing that I love about the Adirondacks, the thing that I really like about the Adirondacks is the Adirondacks is kind of like this whole public-private partnership for keeping the land intact. So when you go up to the Adirondacks, you have all these areas, you have all these park areas, so the New York State Park System, right? And those are normal state parky type things, right? And obviously, they're parks, lots of trees, can't do much there. Then outside of that, you have a bunch of people who have bought houses and such. But the thing is where they bought houses, there's a lot of regulation on what you can do with the houses to keep the environment looking very natural. So, like, there are some of the lakes up there, like Saranac Lake, Upper Saranac Lake and Middle Saranac Lake and Lower Saranac Lake, whatever, like the lake system. And, like, one of their housing things there is that if somebody looks at the lake from the top of the mountain or whatever, that they can't see the houses. So that's kind of like one of the interesting things there. So there's a lot of houses, there's a lot of camps, there's a lot of RV parks. But the regulations are such that they have to fit in with the environment. And then you have nice little towns. So you can go, a little hair there, go get a pizza, get a beer, anything like that, which is really nice. Again, so you do a 13-mile hike and you're like, you know what I really want right now? A pizza. And then you go get a pizza. And so what's good about that is you have this huge area of the Adirondacks. You have this huge area of New York that's just beautiful and natural, an immense amount of hiking, an immense amount of biking, an immense amount of kayaking and boating and everything you want to do. But you're never that far from like any kind of civilization. If you need gas, there's a gas station somewhere. If you want a pizza, there's a pizza place somewhere. If you're like, you know, fuck it, I'm like bitten up by mosquitoes and I'm sweaty and disgusting, I just want a couple of beers, you can go somewhere and you can sit down in a bar, in a nice bar, and have a couple of beers. And so that's one of the things I like about the Adirondacks, because that's one of the issues. Like, you go to, let's say you go to Yellowstone, or you go to the Grand Canyon, or you go to like some of these really big national parks, and the thing is, they're huge. They're absolutely huge, absolutely magnificent, right? But it's all natural. It's all natural. So, man, if you just want to go and have a pizza and a few beers, it's just a lot of times not possible. I mean, it's like, you know, it's an hour. Again, you got to think with commute times. It may not seem that far away mileage-wise, but if it's a 25 or 35 miles per hour, it ends up being like an hour and a half to go somewhere. And so that's a nice thing with going up to the Adirondacks is you can go, you can do a nice grueling 15-mile hike or 25-mile kayak or whatever else. In natural, beautiful environment. It's not like you're walking through, you know, you're going through cities or anything like that. Absolutely beautiful. And then, you know, go have a pizza and beer at the end of the day. So that'll be the good thing. So we'll be going up to Adirondacks, like I say, in about 2 weeks. And we'll be gone for about 2 months up there. So Silicon Trailer and all that will be continuing. So so if you're interested in meeting me anywhere, just so you know, that will be happening up there. We have to figure out exactly where we're going to be. But basically, if you know what the hell the Adirondacks are, we will be in the Adirondacks, I think. Unless we go a little bit this way. Our plan now, and again, being out there, being on the road, is we probably will stay at each RV park there for 2 weeks at a time. So like 2 weeks here, and 2 weeks here, and 2 weeks here, and 2 weeks there. And again, just because we've realized, again, like I said, maybe it's just being a little older or whatever, that you really can't see a lot, even with a week. So like doing this time, we gave ourselves a week, which actually only turns out to be about 6 days of usable days there. And then again, that's not much. I mean, even if you hike six trails, even if you're out hiking every single one of those days, that's only six trails. And a lot of these parks have hundreds of trails, right? So I think we're gonna go for a minimum of 2 weeks there, and we'll see how that goes. Oh, so that's long and short of it, all the stuff we're doing. Feel very good now. I'm not wearing my my Under Armour shirts. So I had, just so everybody knows, I don't wear the same Under Armour shirt all the time. I wear, I have six of those. I have six of those Under Armour shirts. But it's nice, now that I'm home, I can wear cotton again. It's kind of like one of those things, like cotton shirt, it's a small pleasures in life. It's a small niceties in life. Like normally you don't realize how nice cotton feels until you're out there wearing like nylon and plastic clothing for like weeks at a time. And then you come back and it's just like, oh. It's kind of like when I went on the backpacking trips and I get the, you know, the special like travel pants. And there was nothing, almost nothing in the world feels better than having spent months and months and months in travel clothing, and then that first time when you slip on your favorite pair of jeans. Oh, like that first time you slip on blue jeans after, you know, I don't know, 3 months, 4 months being on the road, you're like, wow, that just feels absolutely awesome. Oh, so yeah, we're back here. It's kind of weird. We have the travel trailer sitting in the driveway, and we're unpacking it right now so we can clean it up and repack it. And every time my wife and I walk in the travel trailer, it's kind of like, oh, are you sure we can't sleep out here tonight? It is funny though. That's one of the reasons I talk about all this kind of stuff, is because it really is amusing, like this whole concept of what is home and what do you need and what is comfort and all that kind of stuff. Because like here, like I have a king size, but I have like an awesome king size bed. It's like the feather, like one of those beds that they custom to whatever to you. It's king size and it's got the umpteen zillion count sheets on it and the whole nine yards. And it's like, I like the bed in the travel trailer. Like the bed in the travel trailer is like the cheapest ass mattress you can possibly buy. It does have a little memory foam thing on top. And then it has Walmart, like literally Walmart sheets on it. Very inexpensive Walmart sheets. It's like, but it's so comfy and it's just so cozy. It's curious. Is that whole curious? What do you really want in life? What do you really need? Because I'm just sitting here at this big old house. That's our question, because we've really been talking about it more and more. And so the question is, when do we get the real estate agent over here and start talking about it? Because that's the other problem too, is like, because some people say, oh, well, why don't you just sell it now? And again, there's this whole process to selling, because then you got to put it on the market, and before you put it on the market, you have to fix all these stupid little things. And it's amazing how much time it takes to fix all these stupid little things, but all those stupid little things have to get fixed, and this has to be done, and this has to be done. Then we have to figure out what furniture we're keeping, and what furniture is going, and this, that, and the other thing. Then we have to put it on the market, and if it does, so I don't know, I'm trying to figure that one out. And then if it does, you know, but oh well, we'll go through that whole mess with a row house finally getting rid of the row house in Baltimore. I'll be very happy on that. Again, for anybody out there thinking that real estate's a good investment, let's just say after 11 years, we're just going to take a hit on that bastard. We bought the, and that's the thing, like with real estate, it really does suck. Like everybody talks about how real estate is this great investment. And the thing is to understand, for some people, real estate may be a great investment. It may be your massive nest egg. But you do have to realize it's a risk. And that's what I hate in our modern society is, and again, why I do fail normal. It's because everybody lies to you. Everybody lies to you. And it's not, you know, there are some, you know, some people are going to lie to you. Like the person selling the house. You know the person selling the house is going to lie to you because they're trying to sell the fucking house and get the most money possible. But you don't realize everybody's trying to lie to you. So you don't realize the people selling the house are trying to lie to you. You don't understand your own real estate agent. I fucking hate real estate agents with a passion. Those are some of the most unethical bastards out there, right? But they lie to you because right, because both agents, so like when you sell a house, both agents get a commission. The seller gets a commission and the buyer agent gets a commission. And it's a commission based off the sale price of the house, right? So you don't realize that they'll lie to you. And then like I say, when you actually go to buy the house, like with our house ended up having a lot more problems than I realized because I had purchased an inspection of the house and I had the inspector come out and I drilled the inspector and the inspector told me a lot of crap. Like with the siding of the house, we had to do the siding of the house, like I say, a year and a half ago or whatever at this point. And the thing was, when I purchased the house, I looked at the siding and I went, I am concerned about the siding. And the inspector of the house said, it's okay. The siding is not in that bad a condition. You may have to do a couple of things, but this siding will be good for at least another 10 years. Mutter futter, the siding was rotted when we bought it. And literally, the inspector, the person that we paid to inspect the house, and again, if you go and you try to deal with these people at all, oh, there's all kinds of laws and contracts and all this kind of stuff about what they actually said and what you actually purchased and all of this kind of thing, right? So you have those kind of people. Like I say, even the people that you're paying to help you, even the, again, like I say, the person selling the house, I completely grasp that they're going to lie their asses off. They're trying to sell the house for the most money possible. That makes sense. But again, you don't think that your real estate agent is going to lie to you. The person that you're paying is going to lie to you. That gets a commission off the sale is going to lie to you. You don't realize that the inspector of the house is going to lie to you. You don't realize like all of these different people are going to screw with you. And then, like I say, with houses, what you have to be concerned about is then you have all these politicians and things, and they say stuff. That's where I got screwed. I purchased my commercial building, my building I had my business in. One of the reasons I purchased it is because all the politicians were talking about all the development that was going to go on half a block away. Half a block away was going to be like $100, $200 million worth of development. Until I decided just not to do it. But you're like, motherfucker! Right? And then you get things like your parents involved, and they want you to buy a house. They'll tell you it's because it's a good investment, and they'll tell you this, that, and the other crap. But what they really want is they want to lock you down to the area. Right? So if you have parents that want you to stick around in the area, if you want parents, and they want you to be more responsible, then they figure if they can convince you to buy a house, then you will magically become more responsible. Look, we convinced Bob to buy a house, and now he's turned into a responsible individual, is what they're thinking. What really happens is every night Bob comes home from working 45 hours a week at his job, absolutely fucking miserable because he didn't want to live in this fucking place anymore, doesn't want to deal with a fucking mortgage and the fucking roof and this fucking thing and that fucking thing, and so basically wants to put a hoagie to his head. I always talk about that. I think that's a modern way males commit suicide. Everybody talks about putting a gun to the head. I'm like, oh yeah, that's suicidal. I call it putting a hoagie to the head. And again, you look at these fat fucks out there, and you cannot tell me a lot of these people, it has nothing to do with simply making a mistake and being unhealthy. Rather, it's a slow boat to suicide, right? Because again, You can't go out. You put a gun to your head, that's suicide. You take pills, that's suicide. You hang yourself, that's suicide. Suicide is looked down on. Suicide is absolutely horrible. Suicide is just evil or sinful or whatever. But here's the thing. What happens if every night you eat like the worst food possible? Every night you eat a nice, greasy, foot-long sub with a super-sized thing of fries, wash it down with a Coke, and then have your six-pack of beer. Well, come on now. When you have a heart attack or stroke or whatever and die 5 years from now, that will be from natural causes. It'll be natural causes, which means it's good. Natural is good. Artificial is bad. So people wonder why so many males are basically putting a hoagie to the head. And again, because they keep getting fed a line of horseshit. So, just so you folks know. But yeah, anyways, we purchased that house in Baltimore. 11 years ago now. Just damn near 11 years ago now. Not only did we buy it 11 years ago, but we got a deal on it 11 years ago. We talked those people down 11 years ago. And we got such a good deal 11 years ago. The person that sold the house to us was pissed because he couldn't make the amount of money that he wanted to make off of it. And with that, I will be highly surprised if we even get the sale price. I'm planning on $100,000 loss, hoping on a $50,000 loss. Here's the thing, that's what, by the way, what people don't understand about like being an adult and the real world of business and things. Like, there are some times when you sit there and you're like, dear spaghetti monster, if I only lose $50,000 on this transaction, it would be really appreciated. If only, right? But anyways, one of those things to be thinking about. So yeah, we'll be selling that house in Baltimore, that row house in Baltimore. We've been renting it out for like 5 years. The whole rental thing isn't too bad. But again, I don't trust Baltimore with a damn. Baltimore, and especially now, I say, after the whole Freddie Gray thing, and there's even more murders now, and everybody keeps saying, Eli, look how Baltimore is turning around, and it's like, hey, I don't, you're right, it's turning around, I got a row house to sell you, you're right, you are so right, why don't you invest in this row house? Let me lie to you for a minute and sell you this wonderful, wonderful row house. It is a very nice row house. It's right on the park. There are so many good things about that row house. If it was like in San Francisco, it'd be worth like $2 million. But it's in Baltimore. So I'm hoping. My wife says, she's like, we will get our money back. And that's the worst part. Again, 11-year investment, right? So, like, S&P 500 returns, like, a 7% yearly. So that means, $100,000 would be $7,000 a year you'd earn. So, like, after 11 years, you'd earn, like, $70,000 or whatever. Is it 6%? It's, like, a 7% return every 6 years it doubles or something like that. But anyways, right, you know, real estate's supposed to, what you're told, what you're lied, every single person lies to you about. The real estate agents lie to you about it, the mortgage brokers lie to you about it, your mama lies to you about it, your papa lies to you about it, your politicians lie to you. It's supposed to be like a 5%, right? So 5% yearly after 11 years. What I should be worried about right now, is how to minimize my capital gains tax. So capital gains is the profit when you sell an investment. So what I should have to be worrying about is my capital gains. I'm not fucking worried about my capital gains. I'm worried about my loss, right? So again, and this is one thing for the youngins out there to really think about before you go out and you buy houses and all that kind of stuff, is again, you folks are sold a bill of crap, just a bill of shit. And that's just what pisses me off. And, you know, that's one of the things, like, with the rise of Donald Trump and the rise of all these right-wing parties. And there's so many, like, the liberals out there and the progressives out there are like, oh, what is this? Why is this? And the reason is because the average person keeps getting screwed nine ways from Sunday. You know, the average person does what they are told they're supposed to do for the good of society, and they keep getting fucked for it. And so at a certain point, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you normally vote Republican, and they screw you, so you vote Democrat, and they screw you, at some point you're going to vote Trump. And really, the question is what do you really have to lose anymore? Because that's what I look at. Like, everybody's like, why is Trump gaining popularity? And as I say, because, I mean, they keep saying, like, Hillary's going to be, like, the third term of Obama. Again, right? Anyways, no. But the thing is, you look at it, and it's like, okay, so you have all of these factory workers. And the reality is, like, again, that's one thing, like, folks don't understand when you're listening to me, is I try to talk to a specific segment, a specific demographic. And because I talk to that demographic, I talk to them in a certain way, right? So my demographic, again, I am in that brainiac demographic. I make money off of my head. That's how I make money. God help me if I had to make money laying bricks. Again, I could go out there and I could, I don't know, do a decent job laying bricks. But it's not how my brain is set up, right? My brain is more set up along the lines of figuring out where bricks should be laid, or how could you more efficiently lay bricks, or are bricks the best medium for being laid? Maybe you should use something else instead of bricks. You know, that's what I'm built for. So like, when I talk about things, I always talk from that perspective. You know, use your brain, find the most profitable niche, you know, think about things as a decision maker, blase, 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 blase. Because I'm targeting the demographic that either is currently a decision maker and wants to hear other arguments, or wants to hear other things they haven't thought about before, or the demographic that plans to be a decision maker. So again, I bring up this guy Kyle Morgan, who's watching me for like 6 years now, and he started watching me when he was like 15 and still in high school, and now he's 21 and leads a programming team. Well, that's the thing. So him at 21, he's obviously successful and going down a road. And so the question then starts to become, for him, it's not necessarily how to code more efficiently. It's not necessarily all that kind of technical stuff. It's more, you know, what should he be focused on? Again, if we're talking about a globalized world, and you want to create products for that globalized world, the reality is you can only focus on so many areas. So when I'm talking about things like Europe, when I'm talking about things like Asia, like if Kyle Morgan is thinking, I want to create a startup company, and it's like, okay, well, the United States is relatively static with growth, so is this the best place to go? Well, maybe if you go over to Europe, is that the place to go? Again, I've talked about that a lot. That's got its own issues. And then to think about, you know, why not look at Asia? You know, that's the thing. Like, how many American startup companies even think about focusing on Cambodia? Right? If you got a large number of people and there's a large room for growth, you know, you may think it's a joke, but why not think about doing things better in Cambodia? Because again, here in the U.S., you know, we have so much food. Our biggest health problem is we're fat. We've got so much entertainment and ease that our, again, biggest health problem is that we're fat. Like, if you look at our problem here in the U.S. is we have so much, we have to figure out how to cut back. So trying to create more for here, right? How successful are you really going to be with that? Whereas, like I say, if you go to Cambodia, if you figure out how to deliver produce or food or whatever more efficiently in Cambodia, then you're actually changing the world. Then you're actually making the world a better, truly making the better world a better place. And again, a buck's a buck, you know. Well, it's a buck. What is it, Cambodia? Forget what the Cambodians had. Whatever they had, the Cambodians had. You know, it's all cash at the end of the day. So, and so that's what I try to do, is I try to talk to you folks about these bigger concepts. And again, I try to focus on you folks thinking more than the physical work, just because that's the demographic I'm going for. You know, that's what I know. I grasp the concept of bricklaying, but I'm not targeting bricklayers here. But why that comes up is, unfortunately, in this modern world, we're really giving the middle finger to bricklayers. You know, and I really, like I say, I don't personally grasp it. If you look at it, the people that built our society, built the American society, and frankly keep it functioning, again, factory workers, all the infrastructure people, construction, asphalt, plumbers, electricians, HVAC technicians, like all of this hands-on actually builds something. You know, it's kind of like one of those things, like with Apple, everybody's focusing on their big new flagship spaceship headquarters that they're designing. Do you realize nobody in our society anymore talks about concrete or rebar or cement or the cabling or the plumbing or any of that kind of stuff? They all just talk about how brilliant Tim Cook is and how amazing this spaceship headquarters is going to be. And they talk about the architects and they talk about the technology and they talk about all this stuff. But nobody ever talks about the poor bastards in there laying, you know, millions of square feet of carpet. And they have been completely and utterly forgotten about. And so I think that's with, like I say, the rise of Trump and all those kinds of people, is because they're actually talking to those folks. Again, when you look at, and that's with all the lies, because that's the thing, is it's like, okay, well, globalization is going to make your life better. Globalization is going to make your life better. So all of these jobs are going to get shipped overseas, but we're going to focus on giving you higher value skills. And you get all the lugheads or whatever, and they're like, fuck. Again, fine. They suck it up. They drive on. Some of them don't. Some of them are pissants. And damn it, I laid brick. And my daddy laid brick. And my grandpappy laid brick. I lay brick. And so they have their head stuck in the past, right? And those people should get laughed at a little bit. A little bit, at least. Because come on, you got to modernize. But the issue that I see with all these people lying is, it's like, okay, you globalize, this is going to make our life better. But then you lose your job. Okay, well, shit happens, right? You're an American. So then you go to college. You go to get your associate's degree. You go to get your bachelor's degree. And it's like, okay, your job has been outsourced, so we're going to give you higher value skills so that you can get an even better job than you had before. And you think, hey, that's not too bad. I'm going to be like an IT guy. I'm going to be like Eli the computer guy. You know, fuck this bricklaying. Bricklaying is hard, right? But then you go, and you get $50,000 or $60,000 or $100,000 in debt in college, and everybody supported you. Your mom supported you, your dad supported you, the politicians supported you, the school supported you, whole nine yards. You go ass deep, head deep, above your eyeballs in debt into college, and then you come out, and as an employer, employers don't give two shits about the knowledge you now have. And now you're told, oh, all that knowledge you got in school, that training program, yeah, employers don't actually care about it. So globalization kicked you out of your job. Then you go to get educated. So what? So you were working. You were working. You were middle class. You had a pension fund. You had health care. You had all the decent stuff, right? And then that gets globalized. So now you stop making that amount of money. So then you decide to go to college. But then you go into debt, right? And then what everybody says, you know, while you're working, while you're struggling, while you're trying to get through, they say, well, you know, the best investment you can have is real estate. So you buy real estate, but then you buy real estate in one of these areas that's going tits up, and everything that the average American is told by all the powers that be is continuing to screw them again and again and again and again and again. And people wonder why they're fucking sick of everybody, right? Anyways, I wish I could vote for Trump. I just don't know who the hell to vote for. Scrapple versus Liverwurst. Scrapple versus Liverwurst. You know, I think the funny thing is, like, whenever I talk about Scrapple versus Liverwurst, or I complain about Obama, this is the funny thing, like with the whole Americans versus Europeans and all that kind of stuff I've been talking about. You notice nobody gives me crap about that. It's so funny. Like, I've been like giving like the Europeans shit the last couple of videos, which they rightfully deserve. But what I find really hilarious is I say so much shit about Obama. and I say shit about Hillary, I say a little shit about Trump, gotta start saying a little more shit about Trump, but I say a lot of shit about America, and you notice, like, nobody says boo about it. Like, everybody's like, yep. Motherfucker. You say a few things about Europe. Oh, what gives you the right? What gives you the right to talk about us? It is kind of a funny thing, right? And it's kind of like that dynamic of the world. And again, that's one of the things to talk about. That's what we're going to talk about today, is freedom to speak. But there is this weird thing. Like, if you notice that in, like, the modern world, like, if I talk about Cambodia, or I talk about Thailand, or I talk about Europe, or I talk about any other country in the world, I will get a huge amount of backlash. How dare you speak about our country? How dare you? But then what's funny is normally in the same comment where they say, how dare you speak about my country, our country, they will then lambast the United States. Just fucking lambast the United States. And it's kind of like one of those things. And I talk about that with, like I say, the European arrogance and other countries' arrogance. And it is kind of like one of those weird things. Like, why is it completely and utterly A-OK for me to associate Hillary Clinton with Scrapple and Trump with Liverwurst? Or vice versa, Hillary Clinton with Liverwurst and Trump with Scrapple, right? That's okay. Like, nobody will say boo about that. But then, like, again, like I say, you say something about some other country. How dare you? One of those things to think about. But anyways, the big thing I want to talk about today, and that does go into the topic. Topic of today. That goes into the whole topic of the day, is the freedom to speak. The freedom to speak. Because again, one of the weird things I find when I go out in the world and I see the world as it is there is what people are complaining about, and then what seems to be the actual problem. And I do find this to be an odd thing. So especially being a YouTube content creator, the hell's beeping? Especially being on YouTube. The big thing that we hear anymore is freedom of speech. Freedom of speech. Freedom of speech. Constitution. The Constitution guarantees the freedom of speech. Which, well, yeah, sort of. Again, whenever freedom of speech comes up, it's always an obnoxious discussion anymore. Because simply people just don't even fucking grasp the Constitution. It's like, yes, the freedom of speech is in the Constitution, but you have to understand what the Constitution means. Again, when we start talking about the Constitution, we start talking about the freedom of speech. The Constitution is agreement. It is the binding law, rules, whatever, between the government, originally, the federal government, and the citizenry. Back in the old days, before my grandpappy was a sperm and his grandpappy's at, well, balls, I guess. The Constitution used to be the federal government towards the citizens. Not actually even the state's government. It was a federal government towards the citizens. So basically it said what powers the federal government had over the citizens and what powers they didn't have. So again, the freedom of speech. Federal government shall not blah 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 infringe on your ability to speak. So again, government with whatever amendment it was that forced the Constitution to also be attributed to state governments, right? And so one of those things is freedom of speech. So basically, the government can't stop you from saying almost anything. Our freedom of speech laws in the United States are some of the most liberal you'll see in the world, even among Europe and other places. Basically, with our freedom of speech laws, it really comes down to you can't scream fire in a crowded theater. You can't see kiddie porn. Kiddie porn is a no-no. No freedom of speech on that. Slander and libel laws, so basically lying about other people, they're actually pretty damn loose here. If you honestly believe that somebody's screwing somebody else, you can say that. If you're completely wrong, if you actually believed it, you're usually covered, right? We got that. And then we have some things with copyright. And normally, like I say, on YouTube right now, it comes up with, like, copyright issues. So again, and this is what frustrates me, is on YouTube, you know, with the copyright issues, this isn't Prime Minister, whatever, Modi from India, you know, using YouTube copyright takedown, or, you know, DMCA to take down videos of himself and speeches. It's not the Turkish guy, Ergnon. I mean, that's the thing. That's what's so funny, like I say, with the whole free speech debate with YouTube. This is not Ergnon. Like, Ergnon, is that how you say it? I always read it. It says Ergnon, right? It's not Ergnon. Like he's kind of scary as far as free speech is concerned. But it's not Ergnon, like beating on the Young Turks or something. It's not, you know, it's not Trump. It's not Hillary Clinton doing the whole copyright thing. It's, you know, one person who makes money off of their creative content, you know, suing somebody else or doing DMCA off of somebody else, doing react videos or things like that, right? But basically, you know, like normally when you think about freedom of speech now, there's these huge arguments about what the government allows and what the government doesn't allow and how the government is trying to silence us. This is just another attempt for the government to silence us, when in reality, it's not really that. Again, if YouTube decides to take down your video, that is between you and YouTube. Constitution does not apply, because YouTube is not the government, right? If the government forces, if you create your own web server and you host your videos on that web server and then the government forces you to take that down, that is a constitutional issue. If YouTube or Vimeo or Facebook takes your stuff down, best case scenario, it's a civil law issue and they've got enough lawyers to make sure that it's probably not even that, right? But that's the thing. Everybody keeps talking about nowadays how this government or that government or the other government is trying to silence us and rah, 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 right? And here's the thing. I say a lot of outlandish shit on these videos, right? I said Europe was the political equivalent of dog's vomit. And I stand by that. I stand by that. And here's the thing. Angela Merkel hasn't said boo to me about calling Europe's political whatever establishment the equivalent of dog's vomit. The German government hasn't said boo to me about calling them dog's vomit. Nor Britain, nor France, nor Spain, nor Ergnon, nor any of these people, right? The people that are actually trying to get me to shut the hell up are the viewers themselves. And this is something that I find very, 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 very irritating down to the very core of my being. Because again, as an American citizen, I have served in the United States Army. I have my honorable discharge from the United States Army. And was with many things in my life, I'm not going to try to make a whole lot out of that, to be honest with you. It was what it was. I got a lot of good training, and I got a lot of good experience, and there were a lot of good lessons to be taken out of it. It definitely has helped make me the person that I am today. But beyond that, again, I talk about in these videos a bit, just because, especially coming as a technology professional, I mean, they taught me my troubleshooting skills. I mean, they are just, like, U.S. Army is just top-notch for doing things like teaching you troubleshooting skills, and teaching you the mentality of doing that kind of stuff in the technical world. So I talk about it a bit. But again, other than that, that's about it, right? You know, again, I don't know, like, what to do when people say, thanks for your service. Like, that's one of those, like, bizarre things. Like, people come up to you and they find out you were in the military, and whenever it's near September 11th or one of these other stupid holidays, I want to thank you for your service. So I have no idea what to do with that, to be honest with you. I have no idea what to do with that. You know, like, right, you know, I did my service. I walked away with my injuries. My injuries still bother me every once in a while. The government gave me cash because of my injuries. And we can walk away with it, right? I did my time in the military. They paid me for my time in the military. We shook hands and walked away. But the one thing that I do hold very close to and very tightly from actually having served in the military and having gotten injured and all that kind of stuff is, again, with the Constitution, the whole concept of freedom of speech. Because I did sign up voluntarily, I did get shipped off to boot camp and AIT and wound up in Fort Bragg and all that. And so one of the things that I really do, to my heart of hearts, feel that I have a right to, is freedom of fucking speech. there is one right I have in this country, it is freedom of speech. Again, I don't even do the Second Amendment. Again, as I talk about with the Second Amendment, what I never understand is that everybody skips the whole well-regulated militia thing. And I actually do. I actually do believe in well-regulated militias. To be honest, that's how frickin' revolutionary I am. I actually believe every state of the union should have a well-regulated militia. Shocking idea. But anyways, right, everybody skips over that as far as the Second Amendment is concerned. But again, the First Amendment is pretty straightforward on the whole First Amendment thing and the whole freedom of speech. And so whenever anybody tells me to shut the fuck up, I really have a big problem with that. I really have an extraordinarily huge problem with that. Because if I was willing to get shipped off, I was willing to go through all that crap, I have my paperwork from the government saying I did my duty. The last fucking thing in the world I want to hear from any snot-ass son of a bitch is to shut the hell up. Because if I served for any reason, if there is any one goddamn takeaway from my service in the military, it's that I have the right to talk. I have the right to freedom of speech. Again, if I am living in France and the French want to try to shut me up, again, not gonna like it, but hey, I grasp, right? You know, if I am in Cambodia and the Cambodian government comes and says, you shall shut up, I'm not gonna like it. But as an American citizen, especially while I am in the United States, when I am posting videos to an American company's site, when people tell me to shut the hell up, I just have a really big fucking problem with that. Because if we aren't serving for at least the minimum of freedom of speech, then what the hell are we doing? And the problem that I see in the modern world, is again, at least here in the United States, I'm not saying what's going on in Turkey or India specifically, but here in the United States, is that we are not getting oppressed by Modi. We're not getting oppressed by Erdogan. We're not getting oppressed by Angela Merkel here. We're not getting oppressed by Trump or Hillary Clinton or fucking Cruz. Oh, I don't know if Trump is liverwurst. I'm not even sure what the hell Cruz is. We're not getting oppressed by those people. The people that are actually trying to tell us to shut the hell up, the people that are actually out there telling people that they shouldn't even speak at all, are actually the average citizens. It's actually the normal people that are trying to oppress the people that are trying to speak and trying to get them to not talk. And this is something that I would have all of you folks to really think about, is do you honestly believe it is wise to tell people not to talk? Right, so I do these videos, and again, I've done quite a few videos at this point all across all my different channels, you know, 2,000 or so, and sometimes I talk about political things, and again, normally when I talk about political things, I always try to talk about it from my perspective, from the American perspective and from the business perspective. So, you know, a while ago I talked about the whole Greek debt crisis. And oh my God, I had some Greeks go batshit on me. And I was like, Greeks, shut up. Shut up, don't worry. I don't really care about Greece. It's part of that dog's vomit over there. What I care about is Greece represents a very interesting warning story for anybody that trusts governments too much with their financial issues, right? Because again, you had the Greeks going along, they became part of the Euro, their politicians started spending money like crazy, they started cooking the books, and then all hell broke loose once the auditing happened. And so, you know, I talked about that, and all the Greeks were like losing their mind, how dare you talk about Greece? It's like, shut up! The point of the matter is if you look at what happens with Greece, it is very similar with what then ended up happening to Detroit, not that much further later, much longer later, like Detroit started blowing up right about that time. And again, you had people, you have all of these pension funds, you have all of these government services based on taxes and all that kind of stuff. Paperwork is a little bit iffy, and now you have all these pensioners who did their time. They did their 30 years, their 40 years, however long. They're expecting to get a pension because that is what they were promised, and now, surprise, the government is saying no. And again, that's one of the things that they'd be having people think about. It's like, if you And this is why I hate the unions. This is why the unions just... Again, that's the thing. It's not that I don't think unionization is good. It is that the current model of unionization sucks. Because let me ask you this question. If the unions are there to support the workers... Again, and this is how everybody fucks you. Even the unions are fucking you, right? Because if the unions are there to support the workers, and the unions go and they fight the good fight to get the workers the benefits and the pay and all that they deserve, the pensions that they deserve, then how in the spaghetti monster's name can the unions feel that they did their job when they argue for a pension fund that they know is being underfunded? How can you go back to the members of your union and say, we won you this amount of pension benefit, when you know, when it's on the books, that it's not being fully funded? Right? The union members didn't get shit if it's not fully funded. If I tell you, here's the thing. If I tell you I'm going to go, I'm your union boss, and I'm going to go and I'm going to fight for you to have a $100,000 a year salary, and then I come back and say, good thing, you know, I went there and I fought for you and I went fist to cuff with management and I got you that $100,000 a year salary. Yeah, we got $100,000. Yay, right? And then you get done to the end of the year and you count up all your paychecks, and you only got $50,000 that year. And then you go back to your union boss, and you go, wait a minute, I don't understand this. You said you want us $100,000 a year salary. Yeah, well, we did. They agreed to $100,000 a year salary. But union guy, union boss, I only got $50,000. So if you got me $100,000 salary, but I only actually got $50,000 in my bank account, Well, the management's doing something wrong. No, you have to understand. See, they underfunded the salary that they agreed to. So we got you that $100,000 salary. But, you know, management, they're underfunding it. Right, again, these are the types of things to be thinking about. You're like, wait a minute. Again, this is a benefit. I mean, like I say, a pension fund is a benefit. Like, you fight for a pension fund, and then you know it's underfunded. Which means you didn't get that pension fund, right? If I come back to you and say, I won you $100,000 a year salary, but then your $100,000 a year salary is only funded to a $50,000 a year level, then you didn't get $100,000 a year salary. Which means the unions fucked you. So, management's fucking you. Unions are fucking you. The academics, colleges are fucking you. The politicians are fucking you. And then, as I've talked about before, your spouse, your mama, your daddy, everybody else is fucking you too. Then again, everybody's wondering, like, why is Trump in the race? Well, fuck it. He hasn't fucked us yet. Okay? But anyways, and so one of the reasons why I speak about all these things is because I find them to be very useful topics for explaining things that people should be thinking about. These are things, again, like I say, talking about with... talking about with Brexit, right? Brexit. So I've been getting a lot of pushback about Brexit. Brexit, oh, how dare you talk about Brexit? You know, Europe this and Europe that, Europe the other thing. But again, like one of the things that you'll notice with a lot of this whole thing with Brexit is that people are complaining that Britain and all these other countries lost power to the EU. So the EU is now controlling them and they want to get their power back. But again, one of the questions I would ask is, okay, by getting your power back, all of these other things happen, which again comes into question. Do you actually lose more power by gaining your independence? Would it be better to go back to the drawing board and try to hash out or argue issues, you know, harder? Again, if Britain is unhappy, the UK is unhappy with the EU, and France is unhappy, that's like half the economy of Europe. If you have half the economy of Europe is unhappy with the EU, and then you throw in, what is it, the Netherlands or whatever, and a few of these other ones, seems like you should be able to go back to the table and renegotiate a lot of stuff. And so again, that's one of the things, like with Brexit, is one of the questions that I bring up as I talk about, you know, here in the US, I can drive from here to Seattle, and it's all good roads, and we all speak the same language, and we all use the same currency. I can go to Seattle and get a job tomorrow if somebody's willing to hire me. And think about how easy that makes life. Again, so like I went from the Smoky Mountains to Baltimore, which is 550 to 600 miles, with zero problem. And so to give you a hint about 550 to 600 miles as far as Europe is concerned, that's like the UK from north to south. So the bottom of the UK to the top of the UK is about 550, 600 miles. And then it's narrower in the middle, right? And so like France is something like a 550, 600 mile square, right? Well, like here in the U.S., I mean, I could drive from the Smoky Mountains to Baltimore, and then we're going to go even farther, you know, another 500, 600 miles up into New York. And so, again, that's where it starts to sink in with how big the U.S. is and how easy it makes life in a lot of ways if you're willing to move. Is, again, we are 2,000 miles wide by 3,000 miles across, and as a U.S. citizen, I can pack my shit and go anywhere in this fine country and get a job and go about my day. And it makes life really easy. Again, one of the problems we get into in the U.S. is people saying, meh, but I want to stay in Appalachia. My papa was from Appalachia, my grandpapa was from Appalachia, my grandpapa was from Appalachia, so I want to stay in Appalachia. You're like, well, you're screwed, because nobody else gives a damn about Appalachia. But you know what? If you're willing to travel, you know, north, south, east, or west, you can get a job. And again, really, it's not too hard. And so again, that's a question, like I say, with Brexit. When you're talking about getting out of the EU, again, one of the questions I want you to be thinking about is how valuable is it to get out of the EU? You know, what are all of the other repercussions? What are all the other things going on, right? And why that comes back, like I say, to an American perspective, is you have Trump. And again, one of the reasons I'm unfortunately probably not going to be voting for Trump. I thought I was going to vote for Trump. I thought. Maybe he can bring it back. Maybe he can bring it back. Come on. Maybe he can bring it back. But what I worry about with Trump is he's really going all batshit about our trade NAFTA trade treaties, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the NAFTA, and the Atlantic one, TTIP. So that's TPP is a Trans-Pacific Partnership. They're like 14 countries, Korea, Japan, a whole bunch of people over there. Then they're trying to do an Atlantic version of that, and then there's NAFTA. And so again, you know, what I want folks to think about when you think about Brexit is you look at what's going on with Brexit and you think, okay, well, that's when you dump everything entirely. And so again, the question is, well, can you just go back to the drawing board and can you try to rehash things? And again, that's what I dislike with Trump is Trump, again, he wants to fucking get out of NAFTA day one. He's like, you know, he was saying that with Hillary Clinton, like, you know, that she should make a promise that she would veto or whatever the TPP, the first day in office, and then go after NAFTA. And again, like I say, there are what I would argue there are trade issues. We need to deal with trade issues with China. There are very big trade issues with China. It doesn't mean we need to get rid of NAFTA or get rid of TPP, get rid of these other things. It's like, well, how can we tweak these to make themselves all good? And so that's why I speak about all these things, so that you folks can think about it. And again, you don't have to agree with me. You don't have to disagree with me. You can take little parts and leave most of it. I don't care. Again, even when you come and you talk to me in real life, I don't care if you take a single piece of advice that I give you. Again, when I do Silicon Trailer meetings, you sit down, you talk with me for an hour or three, and after that, I really don't care what you do with the information. What I think is important is that you can bounce those ideas and you can think about this kind of stuff, right? And so that's why I take really major exception to all of these worthless piece of shit dumbasses out there that say, you shouldn't talk, stop talking. Because let me tell you, I'm actually a pretty relaxed person in the real world, but the one fucking thing I have zero tolerance for is people saying you don't get to talk, because everybody should get to talk. Again, whether you listen, I'm not telling you to listen to me, right? I am not saying every person in the world should listen to Fail Normal. I would like that. 7 billion views a day would be a beautiful thing. But again, I'm not telling you have to listen by any stretch of the imagination. I'm not telling you have to take my advice by any stretch of the imagination. Again, I am not Glenn Beck. I am not Rush Limbaugh. I'm not actually I'm throwing out ideas and concepts to you. And I think with enough ideas and concepts, I can tap you into a direction. But I'm not trying to force you into any direction. And so the thing that you have to be thinking about is with so many people out there saying that other people need to stop talking, this is a very destructive thing. And it's a very horrible thing, because when people stop talking, again, remember, people are people. We're all people. When you can talk and when you can communicate, talking, right, and writing are different ways of thinking, right? So if you just think in your head, you're going to use one mental process. And when you talk out loud, you're going to use another mental process. And when you write down, you're going to use another mental process. So people that really think about things a lot, right? When you talk, you actually get to listen to the things that you're saying. And a lot of times you realize that the things that you're saying are kind of stupid, right? Sometimes they're kind of smart and sometimes they're kind of stupid, right? So when you give people the ability to talk, when you allow people to talk as they will, a lot of times they will end up talking themselves. Again, you hear about this. I talked myself out of a stupid decision. They will talk themselves out of stupid decisions. Again, like I say, like right now, like I say, with the whole populist thing, the whole leftist, I suppose you could say, like, you're not allowed to talk about being worried about immigration. You're not allowed to talk about being worried about immigration. You're not allowed to talk about transgenderism. You're not allowed to talk about sexuality or any of that kind. You're not allowed to talk about it. It's not even what you're allowed to vote for. You're not allowed to talk about it. And so the problem is it builds up anger. It builds up frustration, right? Because people aren't able to work it through. So again, like I say, when you have immigrants coming in, and I saw this. I saw this when I was in California. I've talked with people about this, where, like I say, as an American, a lot of people think I'm a social justice warrior, which I'm not. I'm a common sense warrior. So here's the thing. I don't care your skin color. I don't care your nationality. I don't care which version of the spaghetti monster you pray to. You come to the United States, you learn English, you're here for the United States, you're all good by me. You really are. But again, one of the questions that comes up with a lot of Hispanics that come from the South is this whole thing where they wrap themselves in the Mexican flag and say, I'm proud to be Mexican. I'm like, okay, well, you're here illegally. You're working illegally. Who the hell knows what else? But again, not necessarily the most horrible things in the world. And you say, I want to be American. But it's like when you wrap yourself and say, I am proud to be, I am in your country illegally, and I am proud to be Mexican. It is not xenophobic to be concerned by this, right? It's not xenophobic to be concerned by this. Again, with the whole transgender thing going on right now, and again, our glorious Emperor Obama. Again, I believe transgender folks should be treated equally. I believe it is intelligent. It is a smart idea for transgender folks to be treated well and to deal with things like, yeah, what is the bathroom? Again, like, what is gender? What is a bathroom? But the thing is now, basically how it's all being brought up is you're not even allowed to talk about it, right? Again, with all of this stuff, it's you have to talk in a certain way. And if you don't talk in that way, then again, you're going to be ostracized. And I would argue a lot of stuff, like, say, with the transgender bathroom thing, if we all talk it through and if we can all communicate, I think we'll all come out to a pretty sensible answer. Again, you're always going to have like a 5% of the fucking nutcases out there that are all going to want Beaver Cleaverland, even though what was shown in Beaver Cleaverland was not the United States of that time period, right? You're always going to have that 5%. But I think if we're allowed to talk about it, it's easier to work through. Again, you know, that's where, like I say, with homosexuality, gay people, or whatever. You know, it really struck me once. So I was the straight guy in the basement for this lesbian couple, right? True story. I was a straight guy in the basement lesbian couple. Because, again, I don't care. And they really didn't care about me. And I went off to the Hippo. I went to ladies' tea at the Hippo. I was like the one straight guy dancing in the middle of all the lesbians. It was really interesting. They didn't give a damn about me. I had gay guys flirting with me. I got to look at my inner bear and ask myself, am I a bear? And I had really cute, attractive, successful gay guys like salivating for my ass. Probably did salivate for my ass. And I got to sit there and I got to think, what are my thoughts on this? And I realized stubble makes me want to vomit, right? You know, I was in Coconuts, a lesbian bar, and right? I was with the lesbian again with when I ran Eli the computer guy shop. Again, we had tolerance for damn near everybody there, right? And we were actually known as the Elis. The gay people loved us. Again, hired a gay guy. Again, like I say, across the board. But that was a thing. Like it was interesting because being in this world and being that open to it, right? And again, not being like, oh, snobby, oh, I will deign to see what a gay bar is like. I mean, I was in there drinking beers, partying along, you know, getting flirted with by guys and being like, yeah, damn, I can't do it. You know what I'm saying? You know, having that idea in your head, you're like, Eli, are you sure you can't do it? No, I can't do it, right? But then one of the interesting things, I went to a bar with a friend of mine who was not gay. And so we were sitting there, we're talking about business. I was drinking. And I was sitting there talking with him. It was a loud bar, so you had to speak up. And we were talking and throwing back ideas about gayness, right? Because again, I was with a lesbian politician's aide. And they were trying to get through, at that time, they were trying to figure out how to pass laws to make, you know, gay marriage legal and all that kind of stuff. And so, like, I was part of that, and I knew lots of gay people, and they were my friends, and right. And so I was sitting there with a straight guy, and we were having a conversation about it. And again, like, having one of those straight conversations about what do you think about gay people? You know, what about gay marriage? I don't know. Does it fuck with... I mean, that's the thing. It's like, I don't know. Gay marriage. I don't know. Can they adopt? And that's the thing. I don't know. Would you want two moms? I don't know if I'd want two moms. And again, I don't know, can you imagine two parents PMSing at the same time? I don't know, is that healthy, right? And we just had this conversation, and we're just talking through it, right? And again, I was about as supportive as anybody could be, and I was all for gay marriage, too. Because again, they pay taxes. That's the thing, as far as the government's concerned, if everybody pays taxes, I figure the government should treat them all equally. So if straight people pay taxes and they can get married, and gay people pay taxes, then they should get married. Again, not a social justice thing. It is, that's part of the taxation system. Your taxes pay for the county clerks, right? So you should be able to get your money's worth out of the county clerk. But anyway, so everybody's sitting there talking. And I remember there was this lesbian, I didn't realize there was this lesbian beside me. And then she turned at one point, turned around and said, "You need to shut up." I was like, "What? I can't tolerate hearing you talk about, you don't even know what that," and like fucking lambasted me. I took another beer, told her to fuck off, right? But that was the most amazing thing in the world to me. Because it really was, like the one time in my life that I was truly and utterly intolerant of gay people, like really was like, fuck y'all, was when I was being told to shut the hell up. And again, like I said, I had a gay employee, I gave her, right? And like the one time that I was like, you're gonna fuck yourself is like I say, when you're told to shut up. And so that's a thing that I would have people think about. Cause again, I get a lot of viewers on here and they, oh, you need to shut up. Is to realize when you tell people to shut up, you're actually doing far more damage than you could ever imagine. Again, if you wanna look at most of the fucked up societies out there, you can really tell the most of the society, if you look at it, the more open the freedom of speech is, generally the more stable the society is. And again, it's just a basic concept. The more people can talk things through, the more they can talk themselves out of things. Again, like I say, all these people that want revolution. We want revolution. Again, all these like little nutty ass people in the United States that want revolution. Fine, let them talk. Let them talk. Because here's the thing, when you start talking about revolution, it starts out with guns, and the Bible, and the Constitution, and all that kind of stuff, right? And you start talking about it, and then you can feel comfortable talking about it. Well then, you know, once you talk about the Constitution, again, then you gotta go talking about guns. And then when you're talking about guns, you gotta talk about body armor, which is really cool. And then once you talk about body armor, then you gotta be talking about like tanks and things, and like how you could fuel tanks for your revolution, right? You gotta talk about all this stuff, and that's what scares everybody. Everybody gets scared of that. But then there's gonna be the point where you start talking about, well, okay, well then what's the replacement government gonna be like? And then you start talking about your ideas that don't look a damn thing like my ideas. And then Bob comes in and starts talking about his ideas that don't sound a damn thing like my ideas. And they're like, okay, well, maybe we should shelve this whole idea of what the government will look like. But then how are we going to do services? And then you start talking about things like water service and electricity and the postal service and internet access. And you start talking through all those things. And again, one of the reasons I'm one of the most non-revolutionary people you're going to meet, at least in that kind of way, is because, like, once you start talking about all this infrastructure stuff, you realize that, you know, no matter how bad the American government may be about the Constitution and all that kind of stuff, clean water is a beautiful thing. I mean, you never really value a functioning toilet until after you haven't had a functioning toilet. And so again, all these revolutionary, blah, 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 blah. Well, at some point, the conversation has to get around to how are you going to keep the toilets flushing? And when you get to the point of you're asking about how you're going to keep the toilets flushing, things aren't so interesting anymore. Things aren't so funny. Again, everybody likes to think about guns and body armors and how they're going to die a hero's death. Most people don't really want to figure out how the hell Publix works will work. And so what you find is you allow these revolutionary people, not even nuts, people, to have those discussions. At a certain point, they will end up talking themselves out of the issue. Again, like I say with the whole transgender thing, again, what a lot of people don't realize, transgender is a very new concept to a lot of people. I mean, it's just new. And so again, whenever you get hit with something new the first, I don't know, what the hell are you going to do? But then if you can talk through it, if you can figure it out, and again, you can have simple arguments. Well, if transgender people pay for taxes, correct? Yes. So transgender people need to use toilets, correct? Yes. So in government buildings, those transgender people have paid money for the toilets in those buildings, correct? Yes. So therefore, they should have the right to be able to pee in peace, right? Yes. Okay, then how are we going to allow them to pee in peace? Now that we've agreed, Socratic argument, now that we've agreed that taxpayers should be able to piss in peace, how are we going to allow that to happen? Again, like I say, what I would actually say with the transgender thing, it's really interesting. The one thing nobody's ever talking about is why the hell we still have gendered bathrooms at all. Again, it was interesting. I was in Seattle, right? So I went out to Seattle and I went to, I don't know if it was Galvanized, one of these co-working spaces, right? And it was funny, right? So I go into one of these co-working spaces, and then all the bathrooms in this co-working space are unisex. Again, you walk in, there's a sink, and there's a toilet. And they're all unisex, both male and female. And the funny thing is you walk in there, and they have this big piece of paper that talks about how they're part of the social justice movement. The reason that all of our bathrooms are unisex is for social justice, you know, transgender, blah, 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 blah. But then I looked around, and again, I'm a common sense warrior, and looked at it and was like, well, doesn't unisex bathrooms make a hell of a lot more sense in almost every environment? Right? Because again, like if you go into an office building, and you make 5 male toilets, and you make 5 female toilets, fuck the transgender people. Let's not even worry about the transgender people, just look at it. Well, let's say on that floor, it's all marketing professionals, and the marketing professional right now skews female. So, I don't know, 80% of the employees are female, and 20% are male. So that means, potty parity, the men, percentage-wise, have a lot more toilets than the women have. Is that fair? Right. And then think about, like, let's say you have a program, it's a coding department, a programming, a tech department, right? And right now, you know, there's way too many males in tech. So right now, you go in there, and there's 5 women toilets and 5 men toilets, and it's 95% men. So the women can go to the bathroom anytime they want, and the men are, like, waiting in a damn line. Well, then the problem happens, like, what happens if it skews? Then what happens if you start getting more women? Right? I don't know. What if women takes off for women and now they're coding? And so now you have like 90% women. And again, 90% women and 10% men. And then right? And you have all these bathroom problems because we have sexed bathrooms. So again, if we actually really discuss the problem and we actually have a conversation about the problem, we think about the thing. One of the questions that I would have come up is why do we have sexed bathrooms at all? Why is it Why don't we improve the efficiency of our bathrooms by making them unisex? And again, then you may even be able to shrink the footprint. Instead of having to have 5 women's stalls and 10 men's stalls, if it's unisex, you may even be able to save money and resources by having 7 unisex bathrooms. Right? And again, this is just a discussion, but you need to be able to have the discussion. You need to be able to say, I don't feel comfortable with a woman pissing beside me at a urinal. And not be bastardized for it. Not be told you're a bigot or a piece of shit or worthless or anything like that. You need to be able to say, look, I was born with the different body parts than I have now. And, you know, I look like a cowboy or I look like a model, you know. What, again, like I say, if you have a gender card, and on your thing it says you're a male, and then you walk into the boys' bathroom and you look like Caitlyn Jenner, does this make sense? I don't feel comfortable with this. And everybody can come and they can have a discussion and you can get somewhere. But what I feel so much nowadays is, again, everybody worries about the First Amendment. The First Amendment, Eli, First Amendment, the First Amendment's fucking fine. The First Amendment's fine. If you look at it, First Amendment's fine. That's not the issue. The issue is individual people telling each other that they're now not allowed to talk. It's when you have the arrogance. Oh my God. Holy shit. I wish I could have taken that video. That was fucking awesome. That was awesome. I wish I had like a video camera. Like, that was awesome. Like, holy shit, that was cool. We have great blue herons. We have great blue herons that come and they consider the pond a buffet. Oh my God, that was fabulous. And so great blue herons are these big birds, right? They got a wingspan like bigger than mine, right? These little legs and all that kind of, and I swear to you, this great blue heron came out of the sky, all swooped out, went like 4 feet behind this camera at like 3 feet, and then angled up and into the trees. That was fucking awesome. That was cool. That was wicked cool. Unfortunately, you didn't see that. That was like amazing. Yeah, see, it's up there now. Will it do it again? Come on. Rewind. We live in the Netflix culture. I think I should be able to rewind that. It is funny, like being like the, like you get so used to like Netflix, you're like, pause it so I can show somebody else. Rewind. You can't pause and rewind real life. That was awesome. Anyways, I had a point. But anyway, that's the whole thing. And so what I would argue in this modern world, the bigger issue, again, isn't so much the freedom. Again, here in the United States, again, if you're in Turkey, you're in Turkey. Here in the United States, it's not the First Amendment. It's really not. And like, if you look at it, it's just not. What it is everybody telling each other, you're not allowed to speak about that, right? You're not allowed to speak about the Second Amendment. You're not allowed to speak about Brexit. You're not allowed to speak about Greece. You're not allowed to speak about Cambodia. You're not allowed to speak about this, about that, and the other thing. And then, like I say, is if you're not allowed to speak about it, then you can't have a conversation. And again, even if you think I have my head up my ass, one of the things to be thinking about is I'm giving you my opinion. And again, I listen to the media stuff. I read the Wall Street Journal. I read The Economist. I read a lot of this other stuff. I read books about all this kind of thing. And so again, if you want to think about it, and you're like, well, Eli's opinion is all assed up. Again, if I'm somebody that actually tries to keep up with this kind of thing, and you think my opinion is all assed up, then what does that mean about everybody else? And also, what does that mean about your communication? It's kind of like with that. That's one of the things now with the whole progressives and the liberals. They keep bitching that you know, like I say, the working class or whatever is voting against their own good. They're voting against their own interests. Don't they understand how valuable globalization is? But I really honestly have to tell you, they're not putting out very good propaganda on how good globalization is. Again, I support globalization because I read through all the paperwork. I'm a business person. I'm a technology person. And again, I want more integration because, fuck, I wade through a lot of information to figure that out. But again, if you look at it from just basic advertising point of view, if you look at the Republican Party in the United States, they want globalization, they want all this stuff, but they do a shit job of advertising it. Again, like I say, with Obama, with Emperor Obama, again, just because he's emperor doesn't mean he's a good emperor. Just because he decrees doesn't mean things actually happen, right? Bad emperor, ineffective Emperor Obama. Again, if you look at Obamacare, everybody's screaming like, oh, don't people understand the value of Obamacare? No, we don't. You've done a shit job advertising it. So again, it's like instead of telling people that they can't talk about Obamacare, instead of telling them they can't talk about immigration, instead of saying they can't talk about race and sex and all these kind of issues, maybe a lot of it is the advertising is really piss poor. And maybe if you did a little bit better effort, things would go better. Again, like I say, with Obama and all that, I remember when Eric Holder, a proud moment. I had a proud moment with Eric Holder for all of like 2 hours. I remember when Eric Holder came out. He was African American. He was our attorney general for a while. And he said that Americans were cowards for not being able to talk about the race issues in the United States. And I was like, hallelujah, praise the Lord, speak it, brother. That was an awesome moment in time. Until you saw how the conversation got slanted. And you're like, yep. I hate to tell you, but this is why nobody is comfortable talking about race issues. Because you sit here and you say, you're all cowards for not willing to speak about race issues. And then when you see how the administration frames everything, again, like I say, if you look at it now, I would hate to be a police officer right now. Again, because again, I believe in police body cameras. I believe in holding police responsible. I believe in a fucking Yelp system for police officers. I really do. Like police officers are, at the end of the day, they are civil servants. They are here for the citizenry, right? But on the other hand, you do. They take, I mean, the politicians are taking these small, taking these issues, and then just like, and you're like, yeah, well, this is why we can't talk about race, right? Again, like I say, with Baltimore, fuck Baltimore. But, you know, you've got Freddie Gray, and Freddie Gray has a whole bunch of issues. Freddie Gray has a whole bunch of issues that need to be talked about. But again, you have the political prosecutor going after every police officer that fucking touched Freddie Gray. You're talking about older people, you're talking about younger people. You're talking about males, you're talking about females. You're talking about black, you're talking about white. You're talking about different police officers with entirely different functions, and the fucking prosecutor took them all to court. And you're like, yeah. No wonder the police are fucking fed up. Again, if they had taken the paddy wagon driver to court, you might be like, okay, paddy wagon driver screwed up. Or if they took one person to court, no, the politicians are like, yeah, fuck you. Right. And again, we can't have this discussion. We can't, you know, you can't talk, and that's the thing, like, you can't talk about in the U.S., like I say, with the whole police officers and police violence. You are not allowed to talk about the fact that friends of mine who were paramedics, when they went to certain areas of the city, they had to wear body armor. Fucking paramedics had to wear body armor in order to go in and patch people up. Because guess what? If you shoot somebody and they die, they can't be a witness at your trial. If you shoot somebody and they live, they can, or there can be retribution. So you have paramedics that are spending their lives to help people have to wear body armor because they have to worry about getting shot when they respond to the person that got shot. And then we wonder why police officers act certain ways in certain neighborhoods, but you're not allowed to talk about that. And again, like I say, if we have more conversations, and again, then you can have the conversations of what's going on with education and this and that, and you can go back and forth. What happens so much is one person gets a soapbox, and they can scream their brains out, and then the other person gets their scope. But you can't have that conversation. Again, like I say, I'm a common sense warrior. I think it is absolutely and utterly abhorrent how racist Baltimore City is. Like, the power structure of Baltimore City is god-awful racist, and it really is anti-African-American. Like, to the core, it's anti-African-American. On the other hand, when you have 340 murders last year, and frickin' 95% of it is African-American versus on African-American violence, that's also an issue. But we need to go back. We need to be able to have this conversation. Yes! Yes, there is institutional bigotry. There is institutional racist. Yes, your neighborhood is fucking scary as hell. Right? So how do we come together and figure it out? But people don't want to have that conversation. They say, you're not allowed to talk about it. Eli, you're not black, so you're not allowed to talk about it. Eli, you're not a police officer, you're not allowed to talk about it. Eli, you're not a politician, so you're not allowed to talk about it. Yeah, right? You're not, blah, 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 blah. Again, as I would say at the end of the day, like I talked about before, I think we're all just trying to get along. There's a very interesting book on sociology, war, and all that kind of stuff. And it really did talk about how, at the end of the day, 99% of humanity really is simply trying to figure out how to make their lives better. They're trying to figure out how to feed themselves, how to shelter themselves, and how to give their kids a better life. That's what 99% of humans are doing. 1% of the humans are just batshit crazy. But 99%. Trying to feed themselves, trying to shelter themselves, trying to give their kids a better life. The problem you run into is, again, they do those things in dysfunctional ways. They do those things in maladaptive ways. Again, you have to think about, in a way, how sad it is that so many street-level drug dealers get charged criminally. Because, again, a street-level drug dealer doesn't make a lot of money. There's a lot of studies where they actually make minimum wage. So they're doing street-level drug dealing to pay the fucking bills. It's their job, right? So again, we got to get them out of drug dealing. But giving them an arrest record, how does that work out? I mean, these are people that are actually working, but we're not allowed to say that. I'm not allowed to say that really a drug dealer is a disciplined, you know, he shows up to work on time, even if work starts at 10 o'clock at night. He's diligent. He's out there in the rain and the slush and the crap, right? He's willing to protect his merchandise. You're not allowed to say that in a lot of ways a drug dealer is the type of person you want in your neighborhood if they did all those things in a niche other than drugs, right? But you're not allowed to talk about those things. So anyways, that is my thing. The freedom to speak. The freedom to speak. You should be able to say that Americans are worthless pieces of shit. And I should be able to say that Europe is the political equivalent to dog vomit. And as we start that conversation, we can come together. Come together. Because that's it. You know what I'm saying? It's all about conversation. It's all about all of us talking ourselves out of stupid ideas. Again, I mean, you just sit there and you just think about it. And at the end of the day, it all kind of works itself out. Again, that's one thing I found in business. That's the thing, like, I found in business, and I found traveling all over the world and doing all the kinds of wacky stuff that I've done, is you start on your high horse. You start on the high horse, the highest horse you can find. When you go out in the world, the first thing you do is you buy the highest horse you can find. You ride that high horse. And then somehow that high horse just starts getting chopped down a little bit more and 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 a little bit more. Because that's the thing. You start out with all of these ideals and then you run in to trying to get something accomplished. And you're like, I can keep all of these ideals and get nothing done, or I can be a little flexible. Maybe a little more flexible. A little flexible. Well, you know, I really don't care about that. So, yeah, right. And then, you know, like I say, that high horse, that all those ideals, at some point. Right, again, that's the thing. Like, if you ever deal with old white men, I have been very lucky. I have been very lucky. Because very old, very white men, for some reason they like me. Or they did like me. Now I'm starting to get to the age, I think they get a little worried about me. Maybe I'm just getting to be old myself, I don't know. But they did used to like me. And that's one of the things that I found with old white men, very old, very white men, you know, those type of old white men, is that when you talk to them, it's like talking to a marshmallow. It really is. It's like talking to marshmallow fluff. Right, so like you go into like the inner city, or you go into like working class people or whatever, and there's like a lot of hard edges. There's a lot of cutting, right? There's like, there's a lot of armor. When you go talk with very old white, very white men, they're like talking to white marshmallow fluff. Like everything you say to them, just kind of goes in and kind of like rolls around, right? They're just so nice, and they don't really argue with you about anything at all. And they don't really say anything that's gonna really like piss you off. You just have, alright. Because what they found is at the end of the day, it's just not worth pissing people off. It's like if you piss people off, then they won't deal with you anymore. So they're kind of like marshmallow fluff. They're just like, bro, alright. That's what you find is if the conversation is open and if you can keep talking. As long as you don't cut off the conversation, you can always do a deal. That's a thing, right? That's what old white men know. The secret to being an old white man is that as long as you can talk, you can deal. As soon as you can't talk, you can't deal. And the only way to make money, and the only way to be successful, is to deal. So you always keep the conversation going. And that's what you find about the old white men. Again. I will tell you at a certain point, they'll tell you to go fuck off. But anyways, that's a story for a different time. They do have their edges. They do have their edges. It's just, like, there's about, like, 5 feet of, like, marshmallow fluff around the sharp edge. But if you dig hard enough, you'll find that sharp edge. Right. But anyways. But yeah, but that's a thing. And so I think that's a thing to like be thinking about. Because again, like I say, as long as people are talking, you can figure out a solution. As long as you're talking, you can negotiate. As long as you're talking, right? And again, as you're talking, see, everybody wants like the hard answers. They want the hard. I am right and you are wrong. I am right and you are wrong. And I will not stop until you not just agree with me, but agree that you're wrong. And again, that's what these marshmallow fluff old white men do. They just kind of tap you. You know what I'm saying? Like a martial arts, right? If you're trying to do something, right? You think about being hard. Yeah, I'm going to be hard. I'm going to be strong, right? That's the thing with these old white men. They just go, pop, pop, pop. And you don't even feel it. You don't feel it. They just kind of tap you. Kind of tap you. It's like the flutter of a gnat's wings, right? That's kind of funny, because at first you're like, wow, this old white man doesn't even realize how weak they are. But what you don't understand is they can just tap you, but they'll just keep fucking tapping you. And you barely even notice that they're tapping you. And that's the thing, like you're thinking like hitting people, but they're just tapping you. And they tap you 100 times, they tap you 1,000 times, they tap you like fucking 50 fucking thousand times. And then they get a couple of other white marshmallow fluff people in there, and they're all kind of just tapping you. And then like all of a sudden, you're moving in this entirely different direction. Because if you get fluttered by a gnat's wings fucking a million goddamn times by 50 different people, you end up going in an entirely different direction. And you won't even realize that you changed course. And what the old white men realize is if you put the ego away, and if you put the arrogance away, if you put the wanting people to worship you and respect you and all that matters is, can I get this motherfucker going in that direction? Because that's the thing, they just flutter you, in that direction. And once you go in that direction, they win. And then they get more people going in that direction. And then all of a sudden, there's like 50 or 100 people going in the direction that they want people going in. And going down that way, that's where they get power. Fluttering along, right? But you can only flutter, you can only do that if the conversation is open, if you can talk, if you can negotiate, if you can deal. All right? If you can, every time you see a person, you just mention a little something. Not something hard, not something just like, oh yeah, hey yeah, oh yeah. But anyways, so that's my thought for the day. Started off strong, then turned to marshmallow fluff. Again, you just tap people along. Again, because it's not important. It's not important if they even realized that you made them change their perspective. It's not important that they say, thank you for changing my mind. All that's important. Can you just tap them along, right? And get that off the conversation. Because as soon as they end the conversation with you, then it's done. So anyways, that's the conversation for today. Hour and a half. I feel good though. See, again, I try to keep these videos down to an hour because that's supposed to be my thing. But now I'm back home. I've got a 35 megabit per second connection upload speed, which means I can upload this thing like clickety split. Oh, and we even be like 60 frames per second. So you can see my little net wing things. Anyways, I don't know. It's nice to be home, at least for a little bit. Probably by tomorrow night, I'll be like antsy, want to go somewhere. But anyways, we'll only be here for 2 weeks. So with that, I think we'll call it a day. Anything else? No, I think that's it. So just something to think about. If you believe in the First Amendment, one, the First Amendment is probably not what you think the First Amendment is. But two, if you really believe in freedom of speech, stop telling other people to shut the hell up. Again, have a discussion with them. Point out things to them. But again, that's the whole thing. Like I would say with the discussion is, you know, I talk about the banhammer that I block people. Think about when you're discussing things with people, if how you're discussing it is going to get the banhammer on you. Right? Think about, even if you're in the right and even if you're perfect and all that kind of stuff, when you push back, think about if you reasonably believe that the person would do the equivalent of banning you. And if they would, maybe you need to reword what you're saying. Because as soon as they ban you, then you're gone. Right? But anyways, that's for the thought for the day. So with that, we'll call it a day. I will see you folks tomorrow.